giving, and we've been challenged to put these hampers together, and we've been challenged to give to different food banks and the Salvation Army and all these things. We've been challenged to do, and I got to say, this congregation is a generous, generous congregation. On your way out today, just stop and look in the back corner of the fellowship hall over by the Christmas trees and just look at the massive pile of stuff that is going to be going together into these Christmas hampers that we're going to be giving out. It is incredible. That is so much stuff. It's just really, really wonderful and wonderful to see. You all just really did an amazing job. It's just fantastic. So thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. And I know the families that we have contacted, we have 10 whole families that are really in need this Christmas, and they are all very excited to be receiving these. So thank you so much to all of you for all of it. I do have a different kind of question for you, though. Have you ever started out something really, really well, and it just took a turn for the worse at some point? You know, I have this problem. It's called I am not an athlete. And any time that I begin a sport of some kind or a game with someone, I actually start out really well because those of us who aren't athletes, we have enough energy for the first 20 seconds. And then after that, it just kind of goes downhill from there. But it doesn't matter what the game is, hockey, bowling, darts, anything. I start out really, really well, and I just go downhill. I remember this one time in college, I was trying to impress this girl with my bowling skills, which I don't know why that was my strategy, because it just wasn't good. So I wanted to be on her team, and I got my friends to put me on her team, and I went out there, and sure enough, the first shot, blam, you know, it was a strike, it was perfect. I was like, yeah, I'm something special, you know. And I walked down, and then my next turn, I get up there, oh, blam, there's a strike. Yeah, I'm pretty good. But I knew that was about it. I maybe had two or three more shots that were decent, and then the rest were going to be stinkers the rest of the game. And I knew this. And yet, I had to get up and perform in front of these people. I tried to get out of it any number of ways. I said, oh, my finger hurts. I just can't. I need a sub. That didn't work out. So sure enough, I'm throwing them in the gutter, you know. At some point, when you're going way off, you even try turning your body the opposite direction so that it'll go. You know what happened when I did that? It went off that direction. It started out well, but didn't finish very well. I actually have a couple pictures of some people who started out their day well, but didn't finish so hot. And these images are captured right before things took a turn for the worse. Take a look at this first one here. These two were at a softball game, and I believe it was her brother's softball game, and they were taking a selfie. See, it started out well, and then they're taking a selfie, and sure enough, that does not end well. You know this. All right, this next couple, they're friends, they're at a wedding. What you don't see in this picture is that both of them are about to have a very bad day, and that bench that they're sitting on, that's about a 15-foot drop on the backside of that. They were okay, don't worry, nobody got seriously injured, just their pride. Okay, next one. All right, I'm sure this guy started out thinking, hey, I've got a shot at this, I think this is going to go great. And this is a freeze frame of what a lot of us feel like life does to us, doesn't it? That's a pretty good one. Okay, next one. All right. I have no idea what the background of this story is, but my goodness, that's a great picture. I just wanted to share that with you. Sometimes we start out and everything is great. We think we're going to do an amazing job. We think we have the power behind us. We think we have the strength behind us. We think we have it all going for us, and we head out thinking it's going to go wonderful. And then things take a turn for the worse. And somewhere along the way, we sometimes get lost. We sometimes get hammered with the dodgeballs of life. Sometimes things just go badly because we choose to make them go badly. There's a story in Scripture about a guy named Uzziah. And it's actually a fascinating story. So if you have your Bible, I want you to find 2 Chronicles chapter 26. This story is deep into the Old Testament. And so it's important that we remember that this story doesn't just happen. There's a lot of buildup towards this. This is a period of time for the ancient Israelites. They'd already split up. They used to have one unified kingdom under those guys like David and Solomon and all them. But the kingdom was fractured and split. And then the northern kingdom had a series of bad kings over hundreds of years, and they were carried off into exile. And then the southern kingdom, the kingdom of Judah, that's the one that we're talking about. The kingdom of Judah fared a bit better than the kingdom of Israel, but the kingdom of Judah had its fair share of troubles. Now we have this king named Uzziah, and I want you to look here, verse 1. Then all the people of Judah took Uzziah, who was 16 years old, and made him king in place of his father Amaziah. Now look at him. He was the one who rebuilt Elath and restored it to Judah after Amaziah rested with his ancestors. Uzziah was 16 years old when he became king, and he reigned in Jerusalem for 52 years. His mother's name was Jecoliah, and she was from Jerusalem. The reason why they add this little detail in is because not a lot of kings had wives that were Jewish as well. So this story starts out by telling us King Uzziah is a pretty important person. He's young. But he's also a good king, at least he comes from good stock. He's the right kind of person to be the king of Israel. The problem that Uzziah had, though, is that he was only 16 years old when he came to power. Do we have any 16-year-olds here right now? Anybody just 16, just 17, somewhere in there? We've got a few of them in the congregation. Would you take those people and make them king or queen? I don't know. There's some 16-year-olds who are thinking, yeah, that might not be too bad. Uzziah became king of Judah because his father was assassinated. And you know, his father had reigned for a while, but his father became king of Judah because his father was subject to a coup and was assassinated. And then his father, he was assassinated as well. In fact, Uzziah's grandfather only reigned for 1 year before he was assassinated. The king before him, he fell victim to a conspiracy against him as well and was forcefully removed from the kingship. When Uzziah becomes king of Judah, this is no great blessing to this poor kid, because he knows that his father was assassinated, his grandfather was assassinated, his great-grandfather was assassinated. It doesn't tell us this in the scripture, but put yourself in his mindset for just a moment. How long do you think he was expecting to last as king? And so he's placed in this situation that is out of his control. He is in above his head. He's young. He knows it. He doesn't know what to do with the kingship. But you know, Uzziah has a secret weapon in his back pocket, and that's his name. Because you see, his name means strength from God. And as we continue on, take a look here, verse 4. He did what was right in the eyes of the Lord, just as his father Amaziah had done. Now I want you to skip to verse 5. He sought God during the days of Zechariah, who instructed him in the fear of God. As long as he sought the Lord, God gave him success. You hear that? As long as he sought the Lord, God gave him success. He had a mentor in his life, this guy named Zechariah. Now, this was actually a fairly common name back then. I doubt it was the prophet that we have the book from. But Uzziah begins his kingship wisely. He surrounds himself with the right people. He realizes, hey, I don't know everything. I can't know everything. I'm only 16. I need help. And as long as he was seeking the right help, the help from people who would point him in the direction of God, as long as he was seeking God, he was successful in what he did. In fact, take a look at some of his accomplishments. In verse 6, he goes to war against the Philistines. Now pause right there for a moment. Does anybody remember that name, the Philistines? Remember Goliath, David and Goliath? The Philistines were a historical pain in the side of Israel. They were constantly pressing the Israelites and the kingdom of Judah. They were constantly pressing in on their territory, constantly capturing their people, constantly raiding their economies, raiding their agriculture, raiding all that stuff and taking it back to their homelands. And this guy, he said, enough is enough. He went to war against them and broke down the walls of Gath, Jabna, and Ashdod. Then he rebuilt their own towns near Ashdod and elsewhere amongst the Philistines. God helped him against the Philistines and against the Arabs who lived in Gur Baal and against the Meunites. The Ammonites brought tribute to Uzziah. That means the enemies around him said, ho, this guy is for real. We better pay him off to keep him off our backs. The Ammonites brought tribute to him, and his fame spread as far as the border of Egypt because he had become very powerful. Uzziah's influence spread over the land. In fact, this short description is the only time in the kingdom of Judah's history that the power of that kingdom was like the days of old, the days of David and Solomon. He was that kind of king. He was powerful. And he was powerful for a lot of reasons. Take a look at verse 9. Uzziah built towers in Jerusalem and at the corner gate. Now, these towers aren't like what we would consider towers. These towers were for military purposes. They were defensive and offensive at the same time. It means that he took Jerusalem and said, this needs to be protected. This is important. And so we are going to invest and invest and invest, and we are going to make sure it stays in our hands. So he builds them at the corner gate and the valley gate and at the angle of the wall, and he fortifies them. He also built towers in the wilderness and dug many cisterns because he had much livestock in the foothills and in the plain. He was wealthy. He had a lot of animals, and he realized that the people of Israel needed protection as well. The people of the kingdom of Judah, they needed protection. And so he went out and he built towers out in the wilderness. Why would you have a tower out there? Well, so you could see the bad guys when they're coming. See, the Philistines, the Ammonites, all those people around them, they were raiders. They would come into your territory and take whatever they could grab and then leave and go back to their territory. The Israelites, for years and years and years, were not able to maintain their farms and their flocks and their fields because the raiders would come in and take whatever they wanted. He built towers out in the wilderness so that he could not only protect himself, but he could project his power away from the city out into the countryside. These were fortresses. He had people working his fields and vineyards in the hills and the fertile lands, for he loved the soil. He was a farmer at heart. He understood what they needed. He understood what he had to do. He was a good king. And he did a lot of work for his people. And during this time, he had a thriving economy. He made it possible for their agriculture to actually expand, not just survive. Things were going well. He had built up everything that his father and grandfather and great-grandfather and great-great-grandfather had lost. And he took it all back within a matter of years. So let's skip to verse 13. He was powerful. Under his command was an army of 307,500 men trained for war. A powerful force to support the king against his enemies. But not only that, Uzziah provided shields and spears and helmets and coats of armor, bows and sling stones for the entire army. Now, I was thinking about this, and one of the things that countries need to do is make sure that their militaries are strong. Because if you have a strong military, you don't need to use your strong military. It is enough to prevent people from coming. What good would an army of 307,000 people be if all they had were sticks? No good at all. And so he said, no, they're going to have the best of the best. They're going to have spears and armor. They're going to have slings and bows. They're going to be able to take care of us. I am going to take those fortifications and those fortresses that we've got, and I am going to put men who can actually protect us in those places. That's what I'm going to do, and that's what he did. In fact, this is one of the few verses in all of both 1st and 2nd Chronicles where you see a king actually arming and training his military, actually doing the job that he was put into office to do. But not only that, verse 15, in Jerusalem he made devices invented for use on the towers, that means against the towers, and on the corner defenses so that soldiers could shoot arrows and hurl large stones from the walls. His fame spread far and wide, for he was greatly helped until he became powerful. He was an innovator on top of this. Now, those of you, I'm a history buff, and I'm a bit of a, a geek when it comes to like military strategy and all those things. I love watching the History Channel. I love watching all of this. In those days, the peak technology, the highest, best weapons that you could have were weapons that you could stand far back and hurt people from a distance. That's always been the goal in military. If I can stand here safe and hurt you over there, I win. So back then, the best of the best were arrows and catapults. That's what they had. And he realized, well, if a catapult could fire from here to here, what happens if we put a catapult up on a tower? It can now shoot from here to here. You see, he was thinking not just of defense, but of offense. If I can protect my people, if I can protect my city, so that if someone comes in with an army and they're going to lay siege to my castle, they're going to lay siege to my walls, my city, I want to be able to stop them before they even get anywhere near where their weapons can hurt me. And so he was the first one in Israel, not even David, not even Solomon figured this one out. He figured out, hey, if we put our weapons up on top of the towers, we can project power around us. This was a mighty, mighty king. He was an innovator. He was powerful. He was influential. He was a model leader. And his fame spread far and wide. But there is that little nagging little phrase at the end of that verse. Guys, can you put up that last verse once again? For he was greatly helped until he became powerful. Oh, that phrase. How many of us have gone to God on our knees in a moment of weakness, in a moment of fear, in a moment of utter failure, and said, God, I need your help. And God is faithful and just and good, and God always comes through for us, always. Sometimes in ways we couldn't even expect, sometimes in ways we couldn't possibly even imagine. And he comes through and things start getting better and better. And before you know it, we're not only just winning in that situation, we're seeing victory. Things are multiplying. Things are good. Because we've become powerful. And then how often do we go to God in prayer saying, God, I need you to do this. God, I need you to carry this on. God, I need to give this to you. Or do we look at it and say, yes, I did. I absolutely did that. That was all my doing. You see, Uzziah had a problem, and it's a problem that started early, and it's a problem he didn't even realize was a problem. We skipped a verse back at the beginning, and we did that on purpose because, you see, King Uzziah, though he did good, though his name meant strength from God, he had this one little problem. Take a look back in 2 Kings chapter 15, verses 3 and 4. He did what was right in the eyes of the Lord, just as his father Amaziah had done. The high places, however, these are places of idol worship, places where the people of Judah would come together and worship other gods other than God. They would say, these other gods are king, these other gods are Lord, they are the ones that can help us. The high places were not removed. The people continued to offer sacrifices and to burn incense there. That may not sound so bad to us, but this was a big deal to God. And Uzziah, he never earned the respect that he should have about the worship practices of God. And so the very next verse in our story, King Uzziah has gone into the temple himself. And in one hand, he's holding what's called a censer. It is something that is a ball, and it holds incense inside, and you light it. If those of you who have a Catholic background, you've seen these before. They kind of swing back and forth as the priest carries them, and the smoke kind of billows out, and it's said to be a scent that is pleasing to God. Incense has been burned in many religions over many years, since the dawn of time. And he didn't see what such a big deal incense was. And so he walks into the temple carrying the censer that is meant to be held only by priests. And he thinks of himself so highly, he thinks that he has done so well, that he started out thinking maybe he was going to be assassinated, but he's come all these years, and he's done all these things in the name of God, in the name of himself, And God has helped him out. He figures, I can just walk into the temple and I'm going to light incense. And I'm going to light incense to God because it's what I want to do to give God some glory. I am going to do things my way for God. And so he walks in and he's about to light this censer. And the priests come filing in from all the entrances. And they have their hands up and they're saying, Uzziah, stop. This is not for you to do. Please. Put it down. Do not do this. And as they come closer and closer to him, he backs up a little bit and gets his hand on his sword because he needs to strike. He's getting a little cornered. And he thinks, no, this is for me to do. I can do whatever I want. I can light this. And the chief priest says, no, you cannot. God has not given you permission to do this. And so he takes the censer, and I imagine him swinging it back and forth, telling them to get back. Because at a certain moment, it overtakes him that he just has to do what he wants, and he is going to get his way no matter what. And as they're pressing him, suddenly his face starts to hurt. A pain comes into his forehead and down the sides of his neck, and he drops the censer, and he drops his sword, and he starts holding his face and rubbing it, and when he looks up, the priests are aghast, and they take a step back. Because you see, leprosy has broken out all over his head. And he's looking at them screaming, what is this? What is going on? And they say, you need to get out of the temple now. And you know what? He was happy to leave because he realized what had happened. God had struck him with a disease. And so he fled. It tells us in the story that Uzziah doesn't last as king much longer. In fact, it tells us that his son takes over for him. And he lives in a house outside of the city. He doesn't live in the palace anymore. He is removed because he's been afflicted with this leprosy. All the way down in verse 21, take a look at what happens to him. King Uzziah had leprosy until the day he died. He lived in a separate house, leprous and banned from the temple of the Lord. Jotham, his son, had charge over the palace and governed the people of the land. He was a powerful man. He was a brilliant strategist. He was an agriculturalist. He was an economist. He was an innovator. He had skills and gifts. He was a good king. But he didn't care about what God wanted. He cared about what he wanted. And he decided that he could worship God on his own terms. He could go to God on his own terms and do things in God's name according to him. And this was a problem. You know, this doesn't just happen to kings. This type of thing happens to you and I. It can happen easily, and it happens over and over. And usually it starts with our finances and slips over into all the other areas of our life. I know what it feels like to be under the water when it comes to finances. I know what it is like to be in desperate debt and the desperate need. And I know what it's like to come out of that and to build your way out of that and to get to a place where things are okay. And it is easy to allow false confidence to creep in over all the different areas of your life. It is so easy to do. Because when you use your gifts and your skills and your talents and you start using them over and over and over again and you develop them and you grow them and you nurture them, it is easy to look at them and say, that's mine. I did that. And it is so easy to bring that attitude into church and to walk into the presence of God and say, God, look at what I have done. Look at what I have given. Look at what I am all about. Aren't you happy that I am here, God? It is so easy to do. And we can recognize it if we just look at the way we talk about how we interact with God. How many times in my own life have I said something to the effect of, phew, I didn't get anything out of that worship service today. I don't know what that preacher was talking about, but it certainly didn't speak to me. I didn't like the music up there today. Boy, boy, oh boy, do I hate that song. Right? We've all said stuff like that before. And what is the common denominator across all of those statements and the many more and the terrible ones that we can say? It's always I. I read a quote from Francis Chan. He said, "I'm sorry if you didn't like the music today, but we weren't worshiping you." I love that. Uzziah's name meant strength from the Lord, and he forgot what that meant. He was remembered poorly. Take a look at the end of his life here. Verse 23, Uzziah rested with his ancestors and was buried near them in a cemetery that belonged to the kings. For the people said he had leprosy, and Jotham his son succeeded him as king. You catch the subtleties in that passage? Almost every other king, if you look back after they die, it says that he rested with his ancestors, meaning that they would be buried in a family tomb. They'd be buried in a family plot. They'd be buried in the king's plot. Not Uzziah. Uzziah was buried near them. Uzziah's name means strength from God. And when he died, what did the people call him? Oh yeah, the one with leprosy. He did incredible things. He restored that kingdom to a state of power that it hadn't seen in hundreds of years. Under his kingship, people flourished. People had money in their pockets. People had good crops. People had good trade partners. People had good relations with the people around them. Their traditional enemies were silenced. It was the best period of 50 years that those people had ever seen in hundreds of years. And what did the people call him? Oh yeah, the one with leprosy. They were that upset. It's true. It's quite the statement. When he was buried, nobody cared. When you're dependent on your own strength, when you build yourself up as something that you're not, it is easy to forget you. See, in Philippians, we're told what our attitude really should be. Philippians chapter 2, this is a famous passage. Your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus. Now look at this. This thing always makes me marvel. Christ Jesus, who being in the very nature God. You see that? Jesus is God, and we can't lose sight of that. Sometimes we kind of misplace that fact, but Jesus is God. We worship him as God. He is God, and he came to this world, and he came in the most simplest, humblest manner that he possibly could have. And he comes, and he is God, and yet he did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but he made himself nothing, taking on the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee will bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father forever and ever. Amen. You see, humility is what Jesus calls us to have. Humility in leadership, humility in friendship, humility in relationship, humility in giving. Because humility is what Christ came here to do. When Jesus came onto the scene, he didn't ask us to follow him because he was a really great speaker and he was in demand. He didn't come here and ask us to follow him because he had the power of angel armies behind him. He didn't come here and ask us to follow him because he was going to really stick it to those Romans. He came here and asked us to follow him because he was humble and he wanted us to be humble as well, to the glory of God forever. Humility is the key. Humility is the key. And the crazy part about this is that it seems counterintuitive. It seems like we should build all of our gifts and all of our talents up so we can prop ourselves up to be the most impressive people that we can possibly be. But that is not what he calls us for. Because that is incredibly difficult and that is incredibly hard to maintain. And it is exhausting. Instead, he says these words, "Come to me, all of you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Being humble is easy. Being humble is light. Being humble restores your rest. Being humble prevents you from the worry and the stress of life, all that stuff that comes piling onto you. If you give it over to him and say, well, you're the one in charge. I'm just along for the ride. I will do whatever you want. Do you know what that does? That makes it easy. Sometimes my family's together, we're trying to figure out what we're going to have for supper. Does this happen in your families as well? And the inevitable question that I absolutely hate, what do you want for supper? And all of the decision making is put on me, despite knowing that whatever I say, it will be rejected. And whatever I ask for to be placed on my table, my children will say, that is disgusting, I will not eat it. Doesn't matter what it is. And I hate that question, and all the power rests in me, and I have to make the decision for everybody, and I don't want to do it. Instead, I use the cop-out strategy. Well, what do you want for supper? That is a false humility, yes, I know, I understand. But let's think about the principle here. When you step out of that seat of power and give yourself the back seat, when you step out of the place of saying that I am the most important, I'm the one in charge, it's my way or the highway, when you stop that and say instead, I am here to serve. I am here to do what you would like me to do. I am here to do what you need me to do. I am here to give. What can I give to you today? That gives you a different kind of power. That puts you in the same camp as Jesus. That puts you where Jesus wants you to be so that you have the opportunity to see God at work. Because it's not by your strength that whatever it is going to get done. It's by his. It's not for your glory that this thing will be accomplished. It's his glory. And it is the most fun you can ever have in your entire life. Shall we pray? Lord and Father, once again we come before you. And Lord, you have called us to be humble people. You have called us to draw upon your strength, not ours. You have called us to do incredible things in this world, to reach people in the name of Jesus, to help them to understand the gospel, to help them to move from a place of death to a place of life. And all of this is meant for your glory. So God, we just ask for your help. Help us to take on the same attitude of Christ, to humble ourselves, to be obedient to you and to you alone. Help us to remove the high places from our lives, these places where we go to keep ourselves propped up. Help us to be humble and humble of spirit. Help us to love well. Help us to show our generosity in a way that will bring honor and glory to you. For we do all of these things for you, Lord. And Lord, I want to thank you for our people here this morning. I want to thank you for these humble hearts and these joyous hearts. I want to thank you for this time where you remind us of your glory through humble gifts. You remind us of your salvation through a baby in a manger. God, we have a lot to live up to. And Lord, who are we that you would call on us? So help us, Lord, as we go from this place. Help us as we do your will. And it's in Jesus' name we pray.